Hey, so you might have heard of or used Podman or Docker to run and manage containerized applications, but have you used Podman Desktop before? Well, today I'm really excited to walk you through the experience of using Podman Desktop, which is an open source and very feature-rich tool for application developers who are working with containerized applications and deploying them to Kubernetes as well. So I'm going to go through what Podman Desktop is, how you can access it, and its different features as we go from working with our source code for a multi-container application to then build those container images, run those containers, manage, debug them, turn them into pods, and deploy them onto a local and remote Kubernetes cluster as well, and highlight some of the extensions and features that Podman Desktop has. So I'm going to show you why Podman Desktop is so awesome, starting from the website. So if you're looking to get your hands on with Podman Desktop, I recommend you go to podman-desktop.io, where you can learn more about what Podman Desktop can do for you. It's available on Windows, Mac, and Linux, whether you're working with an ARM or AMD processor, allowing you to work with, of course, containers, but also pods and different Kubernetes environments based off of your kubeconfig to spin them up locally, but also deploy to remote Kubernetes clusters like OpenShift. There's also support for extensions, as we'll take a look at, and it keeps Podman up to date. So back at the Podman Desktop dashboard, this is where the containerization journey really begins. So upon arrival, you'll have Podman onboarded for you to set up and install everything that you need and keep Podman up to date on your machine. We're using Podman 5 here, as well as the Learning Center, where you have different guides and learning paths on containerizing applications for different languages and frameworks, but also deploying to Kubernetes environments. And there's more to come here as well. In the settings, we can see that Podman machine is running and managing our containers. We can set the resource limits there, as well as extensions and integrations for a lot of different Kubernetes providers, such as Minikube, Kind, in order to spin up local Kubernetes clusters, as well as kubectl to interact with them, and Compose to work with multi-container applications. We'll take a look at all of this today. And there's other settings such as proxy, different registries that we can authenticate to and add authentication for, say, if you're in the Red Hat ecosystem, CLI tools, Kubernetes context, and more preferences. There's also an extensions page, so you can view different available extensions, such as the Minikube one, which was donated from the open source community, which is awesome to see that vibrant culture at work here in Podman Desktop, as well as extension packs for Red Hat and much more that I've already installed on my machine, such as the support for Docker as a container engine, as well as Lima, and different Docker desktop extensions and native extensions for Podman, such as AI Lab and Boot C that we'll take a look at here soon. Now, I'll go ahead and start from our example application that we're going to essentially build from Podman Desktop directly. So let's hop over into VS Code and I'll show you what we're working with. So today we're going to be working with a multi-container application. We've got a front end that's built with Flask and Python, where essentially we're just refreshing the page in order to update a hit counter that will display on an index.html. We've also got a Docker file here. We're building from the Red Hat universal base image here in order to install the runtime tools, all the dependencies for our application, copy in our application, as well as expose a port and start that up with an entry point.sh in order to find the host file and get the host name for Redis, or just use a default one instead. And essentially that's our application. Now you'll see that I tried to run this here with a Flask run earlier, and because we don't have Redis running on our system already, the application crashed. And this is a great use case for containers, right? Being able to essentially bring up a database instantly, let it be ephemeral or connect it to a volume, and be able to connect our application to it. So let's head back over to Podman Desktop and build this from the UI. Now, as a developer, I traditionally have been using the CLI to be able to build images, but from Podman Desktop, all I have to do is navigate to the Docker file or container file, the directory that I want for my build context, and I can tag it for whichever registry I want to use. So I'll call it Python app test. We can select a platform, and Podman Desktop will go ahead and kick off this build process. So copying in the requirements, the non-root user for our application, and bam, we've built and tagged a image, and now it's stored in our local registry here. Now, of course, we have options in order to load in other container images, which are essentially tarballs of an application, other dependencies like we just did, and import those. We can also pull them from whichever registries that we're authenticated to. As mentioned before, you can add registries if you'd like. But what I've gone ahead and done in the sake of time is go ahead and pull down two different container images. Firstly, this front end that we've been working with, it's already tagged as a V1, and a back end, which is Redis using the universal base image, all those best practices in security, that we have with UBI. And I'm going to go ahead and start that first. So with this Redis backend, what I'm going to go ahead and do is give it a name. If I wanted to give it a volume for persistent data, I could do that as well, environment variables. We've also got settings for advanced networking in order to maybe append host or security for SecOp profiles, privilege containers, things like that. I'll go ahead and head back here and we can go ahead and start this container. And this is the containers view. So we can see that we've got a log viewing area. We've got a terminal in order to run commands, Kubernetes manifest to say, just drop this into a cluster, as well as a summary, being able to inspect the running container, which we'll do now, in order to actually get that local host name for this Redis container and give it to this Python front end. We've also got options in order to, say, directly deploy it to Kubernetes or generate that manifest. And so it makes it really easy to be able to do this all from a visual place instead of having to memorize, you know, CLI commands as well. So we'll go ahead and start up this Python front end. And here we can see that it's actually automatically port mapping port 5000 to port 5001, since port 5000 on my Mac is already in use by AirDrop. So that's just a nice little handy feature that Podman Desktop will do. In the networking here, I will add an extra host, an IP address to the host file. And so this is because of our entry point. So we can customize things very specifically when we start containers with Podman Desktop. And once I go ahead and start this, we'll have this running front end. It knows where Redis is. And if I was to open it up in a web terminal, I'd be able to see that, bam, the website has been viewed as many times as we want. That data is being stored in the Redis cache. And so this is a cool example of a multi-container application going from source code now to running on Podman Desktop. We can also take a look at the logs of this container, being able to see the different requests that we're making to this application, be able to view that, yes, indeed, our application is inside and view the different file system, and be able to view the ports and assignment and also memory and CPU usage here on the right. But this is all cool to be able to run multi-container applications and different microservices, but I want to show you something really neat with Podman Desktop, and that's the Podify feature. So what I'm going to be able to do is be able to replicate both of these containers inside of a newly created pod that will be done and created by Podman itself. Exposing the port 5000, you'll notice that the Redis port isn't exposed, because what's neat about pods as a Kubernetes resource and the most basic unit of deployment is that these containers now in this pod are able to talk to each other on localhost. And so this is pretty neat and allows us to essentially take our containerized applications and start moving them to more native Kubernetes deployments where a pod would actually be used. And we can view the Kubernetes manifest that was used to create this specific pod here that's running natively on Podman, and be able to view the different images that we're working with and some other parameters, which is really neat, and be able to view those aggregated logs here as well. So this is the pod section of Podman Desktop. And as you can see, we can run pods on Podman, but also on Kubernetes, as we'll do here in a second. We can play different Kubernetes YAML files. So say if I have a pod or a deployment, I could play that on Podman itself without standing up a full Kubernetes cluster. Or when I authenticate to a Kubernetes cluster, I'll have the option to deploy it directly as I'm connected to the cluster as well. So what I'll go ahead and do from now is show you that we have the pod running and that we can deploy it to a Kubernetes cluster once we're authenticated. But for developers that are familiar with Docker Compose, I also want to show spinning up a Compose instance as well. So many of you might be familiar with the great game Doom. And so what someone has actually done is containerized the WASM port for it. And so what I'll go ahead and do is actually use Podman Compose, which is another project that's open source that was created by the community, to go ahead and instantiate this using this super simple Docker Compose file that we have here. And so now if I go back over to Podman Desktop, I'll see that we have not only this pod running and the original container stopped, but we also have a Compose instance that I can open up here in my browser, and we can go ahead and play Doom, which is pretty neat to be able to see that running in the browser from a Compose file as well, in addition to having support for pods with Podman Desktop. But the next step I want to do is actually go over to the pod section to deploy this pod to a instance of Kubernetes that I might have running on my local system, so I can do some authentication, some validation, and some testing before we take it to, say, a production cluster and make sure that's crafted for Kubernetes. So I'll go over into the resources section. And down here, we can see that because of the extensions we've installed, we have support both for Minikube, but also for Kind, which is Kubernetes in a container. So I'll go ahead and start that up as it's a bit quicker than starting up a Minikube cluster. And we can see that we're using Kubernetes 1.27.3, that we're starting the control plane. And here in a second, we'll actually have a local Kubernetes cluster that's running in a container that we can do some testing and some development on after it's been created. So we'll come back over here to the containers. As we see down here, we have a Kubernetes control plane. So if we do a kubectl, we can see that everything is working as it should be. And also an ingress was created so that we can access our deployed application based on what port is exposed. So I'll go ahead and expose this service here. We can see the actual YAML for this pod that we're going to be deploying to this local Kubernetes cluster, the same one that we were watching in Podman Desktop itself, running on the Podman engine, will now be running here on a Kubernetes cluster that we have locally. So we can see this, the pod's logs here as it's been started up. We see its environment is a Kubernetes cluster. We're connected here on the top right to this Kubernetes cluster as well. And now we have a UI here essentially to be able to view the different ingresses, routes, services, and be able to actually deploy YAML to our cluster and be able to work with it directly from here. Now, I'll go here just to validate that everything is working as it should be. I'll do a kubectl get pods, and we should be able to see we have those two pods running. So if I go over to my web browser, I'll be able to see the application running as well. So now we can see we have both the Podman pod running natively with Podman, but we also, if I go to port 9090, should be able to see the ingress for this exposed pod running locally in a kind Kubernetes cluster as well. So we can do different testing and validation at this point to make sure that everything is running as should be. But this is kind of the beauty of Podman Desktop, is being able to abstract some of these complexities of having to essentially create a pod manually or create this Kubernetes cluster from this command line, being able to do this all visually in the matter of just a few minutes, going from containers to a pod to now running on a Kubernetes cluster. And the final step that I want to show you is, now that we've done some validation and we've crafted our application for this Kubernetes cluster, I want to use another extension that is the OpenShift Sandbox, which allows us to spin up a OpenShift cluster free to use for 30 days with 14 gigabytes of RAM and 40 gigabytes of storage, and deploy applications there to test things out and make sure they're running as well. So I'll go ahead and create a new developer sandbox connection. Essentially, this will be added to my kubeconfig. And so I'll go ahead and log into the sandbox on Chrome and show the process there. So I'm on developers.redhat.com, where we can actually start our new sandbox instance. You'll see you have access to not only OpenShift, but developer spaces and OpenShift AI. So you have an interactive IDE, but also a way to work with AI models, which is pretty neat, and be able to operationalize that. So here's the token that I need to log in. I'll head back over to Podman Desktop here, as I can set this now as the current context and authenticate. It looks like I need to choose a new name, so I'll do demo. And we've created this authentication and now have it here in our kube context UI here now to be able to take our pod and actually deploy this now to OpenShift. And you'll see that, again, we have the Kubernetes YAML here. We also have the process of these two new containers being created within the pod, and an automatic link assignment so that we can open up this application in our browser here and be able to view this application publicly accessible to anyone, so I can share with colleagues and friends. We can also view it, this new pod here in the developer sandbox, and be able to view the service that was created for it as well, be able to view the pod that's running and any other annotations, environment variables. And we can view this back in Podman Desktop as well. So over here on the left-hand side is where we have some of our different Kubernetes user interface components, such as the services, deployments, and ingresses and routes. And this section will only come up when you've connected to any type of Kubernetes cluster. But we can see that we've got the URL in order to access this application. We've got the different services that were created in order to do that. And we can apply YAML and interact with these different Kubernetes resources here and make changes on the fly, which is pretty neat. Now, I'll come back here and kind of show you some of the last points I'd like to cover of not only, being able to work with Podman and other extensions, but some really neat tools and extensions that the team is working on, such as Docker Desktop extension compatibility, for example, being able to scan my images, view disk usage, but also AI Lab, which is pretty new, to be able to work with LLMs and generative AI for my applications, and run those as Podman containers and be able to work with playgrounds and different recipes for predefined applications, as well as bootable containers, which allow you to get the advantages of both a VM and a container, which is pretty neat as well. So you've got the support for extensions, Kubernetes, and much, much more. And Podman Desktop, this is really just the beginning of what we can do with it. And what Podman really does so well is it eases the flow of going through this container development workflow in order to deploy to Kubernetes environments and abstracts a lot of the complexities that we have as developers where we just want to focus on our code. So again, this is Podman Desktop. I recommend you try it out at podman-desktop.io to download this open source project for your machine and let us know what you think. Thanks so much for watching and have a great day.